What do you call a deer with no eyes? I have no idea. Do you want to hear a joke about paper? Never mind. It's terrible.
I suppose I should make sure that I'm on. I am. Okay. We're good? All right. Good morning and welcome. I'm glad you're here to worship with us. A couple quick announcements before we get into worship. Women's Bible study. There's two times available. I know there's only one, you know, slot on there to sign up for, but there's actually going to be a Bible study Tuesday mornings at 9 a.m. and Thursday evenings at 7 p.m. So either or, doesn't matter. You can see Janet Dunstan to be able to get a book or to get more information, or you can contact her. The information is in the bulletin there for you to see. Matt's for mission. We're going to start making plarn this weekend, March 6th at 10 a.m. here at the church. Pretty much all ages are invited. They're going to be laying out the bags and cutting the bags and tying the bags together and all those things. And then maybe, just maybe, you might actually be able to start to crochet a mat. We'll see what that looks like. But this Saturday, 10 a.m., they'll be making plarn. And then 2 weeks out, men's breakfast, March 13th. And then financial board meeting Sunday, March 14th, after service. So that's kind of the announcements that are in the bulletin. Let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll get into worship, and we'll come back for the word. Father God, we just thank you for this morning. I thank you for my brothers and sisters who are here and online, Lord, just to set aside some time to worship you, to give the praise, honor, and glory that you are due. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would work in our hearts, that as we lift up our voices to you, as we set our minds on you, Holy Spirit, that you would speak to us and draw us to yourself and mold us and shape us into the image of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that we would lay aside our lives, that your life might flow through us, that we would get out of the way, Lord, that you could work, and that you could change, and you could transform us, and that we would be equipped to leave this place and to go and spread the gospel to other people that we come in contact with. Let this be a time of refreshing. Let it be a time of setting ourselves aside, that you could be glorified, and that we would grow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I just want to stand and join us as we worship this morning. Let your presence fill our praise, fill our
Love the road. Your name.
Death has no hold on me, sin has no hold on me. You have the victory. Death has no hold on me, sin has no hold on me. You have the victory. Hey, let's sing this out.
Death has no hold on me, sin has no hold on me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
is who you are, Jesus. You are worthy to be praised. Jesus, you are worthy to be praised. In this place this morning, it's all about you. The one who is worthy to be praised. Jesus, you took on the cross. You took the nails in the hands. You took the nails in your feet. The crown of thorns that made your head bleed, Jesus. You took the beatings. You took the mocking. For us, you are worthy to be praised. You are worthy. It is your name that is the victory, Jesus. It's through you that we have life. Without you, it's meaningless. It has no point, and it reaches an end. But with you, we go on for eternity. Through you, we have eternal life. We have hope that we didn't have. Jesus, you have given us a testimony. You have changed our life. You've turned us around. We were once held to sin. Death had a hold of us. Sin had a hold of us. But because of you, Jesus, because of what you've done, death no longer has a hold of us. Sin no longer has a hold of us. Jesus, you are worthy of praise. Every tribe, every tongue, every language, every nation, you're worthy of that praise. You are so big and so kind, so full of love. So with everything we have, all the breath in our lungs, all of our finances, our whole lives, we say yes to you. We say yes to you, that you are worthy of this. You are worthy of this, of our yes. Here we are, God, send us. You are worthy of this. My King, my Liege, send us. You are worthy of this. We love you in this place, Jesus. We thank you for what you've done. We're just going to sing this chorus one last time. You're worthy to be praised.
All right, so you guys get to participate. We've been on identity for quite some time, a little over a month. And so, as we're going to get started this morning, I kind of hinted at this last week, so maybe you did some homework. I don't know. Right, you get to identify who we are. Right, what is your identity in Christ? What is it that you have been learning about yourself through Sunday, but also through your own personal time? Because I pray that you've been trying to seek out your identity on your time. Because right, you're not going to get it all here. We need to actually be digging for ourselves. And if you've had the opportunity to pick up one of the bookmarks, you could actually probably pull it out and cheat in summary cards. Right? You could just start reading them off if you want. But here's the challenge. Here's what I want us to do. Right, if you're going to say who I am, I want you to say it like you mean it. I want you to say it like you believe it. Right? Not just, well, this is, no, I want you to actually truly mean it from the inside that this is who I am. So for me, right, when I start to look at it, right, I'll just cheat and go with the ones I am, right? I am a child of God. Anybody else? What's your number one identity in Christ for yourself personally? Saved and sealed. Anybody else? You're seen. Loved. Forgiven. Born again. Chosen, absolutely. Dwelling of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to abbreviate HS for Holy Spirit, so I don't have to write so much. Saved. Sanctified, okay. What was the other one? God's toddler. God's what? God's toddler. Nice. Anything else? Fearfully and wonderfully made. I know you go back to that one often, Vicky. You've mentioned it before. Getting there. Anybody a friend of God here? Right? We're friends of God. He actually likes spending time with us. Maybe we don't believe that, but it's true. Made new, okay? There you go. Reconciled. Here's a question. How well are we living that one out? Right? We've gone through it, so there's an opportunity to live it out. I pray that that's becoming more evident in our lives over the last few weeks. We're accepted, correct? There's nobody here that is, if you're in Jesus Christ, that will be rejected. You're bought. Amen. Clean. Anything else? Hey, we've got a pretty good size list going on, which is good. And I think these are the things that we need to start to reiterate to ourselves over and over and over again. Because as we truly start to believe these things, I believe we'll start to live out of those things. And the last thing that I want us to look at, which is where we're going to go today, and I hinted at it last week, is I'm a slave. And so are you, if you're in Christ. Right? And we need to make sure that this is part of our identity, that we don't leave it out. And I think that is a part of our identity that we desire to leave out, because we don't like the implications of it. We don't like the what it represents, especially from our history as a nation and maybe as our, you know, our understanding of slavery as a whole. But I think it's important that as we looked at all of these things, right, we got this list here and we got this list here, and there's many other things that we could have listed. Right? I think it's important that we understand that all of these aspects of identity keep us balanced. Right? They keep us balanced. And what I mean by that, right, and this is why I think it's so important, and this is why I believe even, you know, slave, right, and the understanding that we're slaves is important, because it keeps us balanced. If I look at it from, I'm a child of God, which is a beautiful thing, which is a wonderful thing, that we have a Heavenly Father who cares for us, provides for us, does everything that we need, you know, takes care of us, protects us. But I think we got to be careful, because if that's our only aspect of our identity, is that we're children of God, right, which is absolutely positively true, I think there's a danger, and that danger is that we become snot-nosed kids. Really and truthfully, I do, right? I think we become this spot of, well, I'm this child, and I have nothing to fear, and my daddy loves me, and so I can do whatever I want, and I can tell you whatever I want, and God's going to do this, and he's going to do that, but guess what? We're slaves, too. And, but yet, if we get caught up too much in the slave mentality, we need to realize that we're not just slaves, we're friends. Right? Because slaves don't know what their master knows. The slave is just sitting there meant to be obedient, to be, you know, to take everything. But the fact is, you're a friend as well, which keeps a balance in there, that we realize we're not left to ourselves. So this morning, how many of you are willing to say that before Christ, you were lost and bound in chains walking in the old man? Right? I was a slave. I was locked up. There was nothing that I could do that I could walk towards Christ. Nothing. But I was bound in chains. I was bound to my flesh, I was bound to the world, I was bound to sin, and ultimately I was bound to the devil. Right? We were slaves in that realm. Flip with me, if you will, to Romans chapter 6. We're going to start in Romans chapter 6. Not going to spend a whole lot of time there, but I think it gives us a good picture. It's kind of going back to, if you remember when we talked about being a child of God, that there's really only two fathers out there. Right? We're either a child of God or we're a child of the devil. Before Christ, we were children of the devil. After salvation, right, because of salvation, we're children of God, we're children of, you know, co-heirs, we're sons and daughters, all of those things adopted. It's the same analogy here. Everyone here this morning, everybody that's listening online, everybody who might listen online, we're a slave of one of two masters. There is no middle road. I think we like to think there's a middle road, especially in our nation here in the United States, where we go, we're free, we're independent, we're all these things, which is true in a natural sense. But in a spiritual sense, it's not. But every one of us here this morning is a slave of one of two masters. Romans chapter 6, starting in verse 12. And we just looked at most of this chapter with baptism, the beginning part of it last week. Verse 12, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal bodies to make you obey its passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. And your members to God as instruments for righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. Continues on. What then? Are we to sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey? Here it is. Either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you were once slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed. And having been set free from sin, you have become slaves of righteousness. Verse 19, I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as we once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now your present members as slaves to righteousness, leading to sanctification. Verse 20, for when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regards to righteousness. But what fruit were you getting at that time from the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become, there's that word again, slaves of God, the fruit you get leads to sanctification and its end, eternal life. For the wage of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Repeatedly in that portion of Scripture, he says, you were slaves of sin. Now, because of what Christ has done, because he has come into the slave market, if you will, and we'll talk about that in a minute, right? Because he's come into this world and he's entered the slave market of this world, and he goes, I redeem you, I'm purchasing you out of that place, out of that kingdom of darkness, if we were to go to the book of Colossians, and I'm bringing you into the kingdom of light, in the kingdom of Jesus Christ, right, into his kingdom. But I've now brought you over, and now you're a slave of obedience. Now you're a slave of righteousness. Now you're a slave of God. Well, I don't like to be called a slave. I get it. Slaves don't have much rights, do they? Maybe that's the point. And maybe that's the point. When we start to look at our Christian walk and we start to understand that part of our identity is a slave, maybe we need to realize that it's because we don't get to make a choice. When God asks us to do something, He wants obedience, church. And He wants us to follow. He wants us to go, yes, Lord. Because that's what we call Him, correct? We call Him Lord. We call Him Master. And if you think, you know, I think we, like I said earlier, I think we like the fact that we want to be Lord, right? And we want to play the middle ground where I can have a foot in God's kingdom, and I can have a foot in the world, and I can walk both sides. But that's not the way it works, right? A slave owner isn't willing to share you with another slave owner, right? Your bridegroom isn't willing to share you with another groom. Your father isn't willing to adopt you and then let you stay in the kingdom of darkness. That he wants us to be fully committed, fully on his side, and there is no middle ground. But I, like I said, I think we like the middle ground because then I can choose whether I obey or not. Right? Well, I really like that. I think I'll obey this time, but next time it's really God. It's been kind of inconvenient. I'm with the wrong group of people. I'm with the, you know, I'm in the wrong setting. So this time I'm going to choose not to obey. Do slaves get that option? Do slaves have the choice, depending on the setting, to go, Master, I know what you've told me to do, but I'm really not with the right people, or I'm just really not in the mood, so never mind. No, we don't. Right? Slaves in the natural sense don't get to make that decision. But our identity as slaves in Christ, we too really don't get to make that decision. Right? There's a desired act of obedience as a result thereof. We like to be Lord of our lives, but reality is we never are. We're always a slave to Satan and sin in the world. We're a slave to Christ. We're never in charge of our lives, ever. Feels like it sometimes. Satan will let you, well, even convince you that you are. He's willing to let you feel like you're in control. All the while, he's behind the scenes pulling the strings. But he's like, no, no, you got it. You're in control. You're the Lord of your life, John. You got it. You're in control. And he's like, nope, I'll pull this one. And all of a sudden, I find myself going there, and I find myself going there. I'm at his disposal in the old man. I was a slave to sin, and we need to allow that to happen. So this word for slave, throughout the Bible, if you think about it, you could go back and you could look. In the Old Testament, if you look at the King James translation, you'll find the word slave once. It's not a very popular word in the translations today. It's not a very popular word in the translation since it started back in the 1600s. Right? All these translations came out, and very rarely do they translate the word slave for what it means. It's replaced over and over again. In the Old Testament, this word for slave in the Hebrew appears 800 times in the noun version, in the noun form, 300 times in another form. So 1,100 times this word for slave is found in the Old Testament. And most of them translated slave, a handful. New Testament, there's 150 times that this word shows up. And again, it's a handful of times that it's translated slave. And we're like, well, why is that? Right? Why is that possible? What do we do? Right? And again, I think it's because we started at the beginning, but it's got a bad connotation. It's never had a good connotation in some regards. And then it's even worse now because of the things that have happened. But that word is doulos, right, which means slave, and it always means slave. It's never meant anything different. And you start to look at doulos, and in the New Testament, as you read through it, and you'll look in Colossians, and you'll look in Ephesians, and you'll find a spot where it talks about slaves and masters, and it's translated slaves in that instance, because it's talking about actual slaves. It has no problem with it, as we just read in Romans, translating slaves when it's a slave to an inanimate object. Slaves to sin, slaves to obedience, slaves to righteousness. But when it comes to a Christian's relationship with their Heavenly Father, slave never enters the picture. Slave never enters the picture. They always pick a different word. And the problem with that is there's a different word. If there was meant to be a different word, if it was meant to be translated different, there's probably 6 or 7 or 8 different words that could have been used by the writers of the New Testament to depict that. Yet under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, they were guided to put down doulos. And if you look back at some of the Greek dictionaries, look at the Greek scholars of old and of current, right, most of them say that there's no, without a doubt, Kittle in one of his says this, a slave is someone who is owned. A slave is someone who is subjected to the guidance and the direction of their master. That's what it means. And Kittle carries this on. He goes, the word doulos, right, means slave so unequivocally that there's no study of history necessary. It's always meant slave. Always. And so he goes, there's not really any reason to even look. And yet, repeatedly, throughout history, right, we miss it when we read here. Right, we miss it. We miss this paradigm of how we understand our identity. We need to see why it is. And it's like I said, I believe it's because we want to be in control and it's not a good thing. Flip with me to Matthew. Matthew chapter 6. Like I said, most likely when you open your Bible to this verse, you're not going to see slave. But the word that is translated something different is doulos. Matthew chapter 6. It's all about the part of laying up treasure. Very popular verse. No one can serve two masters. Right? For either he will hate one and love the other, or he'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Right? You cannot serve two masters. In a practical sense, if I was a servant, if you were a servant, can you serve two masters? Can I have a job in the morning? Right? Can I preach here today? Right? Part of my job, I'm serving my master, right? I'm serving the Lord in this aspect. And then by the flip side, go out and go, you know what? Now I'm going to go out and I'm going to go to work at Walmart and I can serve under my master there. Is that possible? Right? Anybody who's ever had two jobs understands and realizes that if I'm a servant, if I'm a hired hand, if I'm not owned but I'm paid to do a job, I can have multiple masters, correct? But can I have two owners? Right? That's what Jesus is getting at here, was you can't be a slave of God and money. It's not possible. You can have one of two masters. You can't have both. When you think about it in terms used as a Christian, right, we're called children of God. We laid that listing out here, correct? We're children of God. We're heirs. We could have added that. We could have added joint heirs. We could have called that we're members of the body of Christ. And we don't mix any of those. But yet for some reason, again, slave is mixed. And we say, well, we replace it primarily with servant. Because servant is more palatable. Servant means that I get a choice. Servant gets to choose. Do I want to go to work today or do I not? Do I want to do what my boss is telling me? Do I not? Right, the servant can go, I'm not going to go to work today. I'm going to allow my boss to find somebody else to do that work. And that's okay in the life of a servant. Servants get to make those choices. Slaves, on the other hand, do not. So we don't want to leave out those other aspects of Christ and our identity, but yet so often the writers have made us leave out the identity of slave. Right, that key identity that's repeated over and over and over again. What is it that we need to confess to be saved? Right, flip with me to Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. And if you were to walk somebody through the Romans road, if you will, right, if you were to talk to somebody about what it takes to come to salvation, right, the Apostle Paul lays it out in here, the message of salvation to all, starting in verse 5 of Romans 10. But verse 9, it says where we come to the understanding of what it is that, you know, to come to Christ, to come to belief in Christ, to be able to profess something about Christ, here's what is required. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is what? Lord? Master, depending on your translation, right? So we're confessing that Jesus is Lord. And if he is Lord, that means by connection, by correlation, by that meaning of us confessing that he's Lord, that means he's the one in complete control, he's the one in complete ownership. By necessary requirement, that means I am a slave. There is no Lord without slaves, and there is no slaves without having a Lord over you. But in Romans 10:9, Paul says very clearly, if we confess that Jesus is Lord, right, then by necessity, it makes me a slave, and it makes you a slave. And that's okay. It's a beautiful thing when we think about the shift, right? I'm a slave either way, right? Either way, I'm a slave. Either I'm a slave to sin, I'm a slave to the world, I'm a slave to Satan, which as we saw in Romans 6 leads where? Death. Right? It leads to destruction. It leads to nowhere good. Or I become a slave to God, which leads to life. Which slave owner do you want? Which master would you rather be under? A master who cares for you, provides for you, loves you, is merciful to you, is gracious towards you, is wanting your highest good? Or would you rather be a slave to the master who is there to just benefit himself? To use, abuse, and neglect you for his own personal gain. All of a sudden, I don't have a problem, right? I'm very glad in my own life, right, that I'm still a slave, but I'm a slave to a new master. Because that master is very lenient. That master is very loving and merciful towards me. Flip with me to John chapter 15. We're going to see it again. John chapter 15. Like I said, when we get to the end of this, we're going to start to realize that it's a very beautiful thing, it's a very lovely thing to have a new master because it actually leads to life. But John chapter 15, right here again, I think is a shift that takes place. I mean, people go, aha, see, that means I'm not a slave anymore. But it's not really true. John chapter 15, verse 14, you are my friends if you do what I command you. How many people want a friendship like that? Anybody? I want to be your friend. You can be my friend. You just got to do everything I tell you to do. That sounds like a pretty good friendship, right? If you're the one who gets to do the commanding, it's good, I guess. But none of us really wants to be a friend that way, do we? But that's exactly what Jesus says. He goes, you are my friends if you do what I command you. But then he doesn't stop there, right? Verse 15. No longer do I call you servants. There again, there is the translation. There's doulos. No longer do I call you slave. For the slave does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. And everybody goes, see, I'm no longer a slave. I'm a friend. That part of my identity is thrown away. Well, that's true if we throw out verse 14. You are my friends if you do what I command, right? There's this understanding in the background that goes, you're a friend if you're doing what I command. So there's already this understanding that you're a slave. But, right? But we're a slave with privileges, if you will. Right? We're a slave with privileges. He says, you're no longer just a slave. You're my friend. Right? And if we're friends of God, right, and what makes that distinction is the fact that a friend is now on the in. As a master, does your master have to tell you why they're doing it? If you're a slave, right, if you could put yourself back in the olden days, right, if you could put yourself in that spot of a slave, does your master owe you an explanation? No. Right? Your master gets to go do X, and they're expecting 100% obedience. They don't have to explain nothing. Zero. Right? And here's the reality. That could be how our God treats us. Because he's Lord. We confessed it with our mouth. When we came to salvation, we opened up our mouth. We said, I confess you, Jesus, not just as my Savior, but as my Lord, which means you have complete control over my life. What you say, I do. And so he has every right to just dictate, but he doesn't. This goes back to that loving, caring aspect of our Father. He goes, yes, you're my slave, but you're more than a slave to me. Right? You're my friend. And I want you to know why I'm asking you to do the things I'm asking you to do. I want you to understand that I'm not asking you to do these things just because I'm some cruel tyrant. I'm asking you to do these things because I have a bigger plan. I have a bigger purpose in mind. Will you do them for me? Will you be obedient? Because through your obedience, your friend or your loved one or your neighbor or whatever might come to know Christ. Through your obedience, God will be glorified. And that's what he's after. Right? And so he lets us in on the, you know, he lets us in to his plan. Because we're not just slaves, we're friends. But being a friend does not supersede the need to understand that we're slaves. Because this friendship is coming from a space that you're my friends because you do what I command. Right? At the root of it, you're still a slave to what I'm asking you to do. And so if you're a believer here this morning, if you're a believer online listening, right, when you came to salvation, right, God purchased you from the slave market of sin and brought you to be his slave in his kingdom. It's part of being a believer. And it's a beautiful part of being a believer. And allowing that to happen. Because when I say he's Lord, it means he's sovereign over my life. So go back to the slave idea. Slave market. Put somebody up on the block. Here's a slave. Who wants to buy him? Right? And the slave owners would walk through and they'd see and they'd go, okay, well, there's a guy who's, you know, got everything that I'm looking for in a slave because he'll do the things that I need him to do in this certain aspect of my plantation or my kingdom or whatever it is. And so I'm going to buy him. And they go to the slave market and they bring forth the money and they pay X amount. And now that slave, you know, is released from his shackles, if you will. And new shackles are put on and now the master takes him home. And now the master is responsible for him. Not only is he responsible for him, right? Then he has to provide for them, right? You have to control them. You have to discipline them. You have to do all of these things for your slave if you want them to actually be effective. And then you look at Jesus, right, and you think about it with salvation in mind. You think about Christ coming to earth, and he lives this perfect life, and he goes to death, burial, and resurrection, right? So he's come to the slave market, and he's purchased us, correct? Anybody here been, what was it? See if I can find it on here. I don't know if it's on here. Maybe I thought we said it, but maybe not. But it's redeemed, right? Anybody here redeemed? Which means we had a debt we couldn't pay, correct? Somebody else had to pay it? Who paid it? What did he pay it with? Right? With his blood? Not with silver or gold? Not with money? Right? Something far more valuable? Right? He lays down his life to purchase us, to redeem us off the slave market. He goes, those are the ones that I see. Those are the ones I want. And I'll redeem them and I'll pay the price necessary, right? He's the propitiation. He's the payment. He's all of these words that you could put in there for. But he's bought you off the slave market. So we've been chosen and we meant it there, right? We've been bought. We're owned. We're provided for. Right? It says that God will what? Supply all of my needs. Because that's what a slave owner does. A master supplies the needs of his slaves. And he's supplying all of your needs and he's supplying all of mine. He protects us. He disciplines us. He rewards us. And I pray that it is your desire that when we get to the end of life, where Christ returns, you hear him say what? Well done, good and faithful servant. Right? But it's slave. Yes. That is the word again. It's doulos. It's not servant. Well done, good and faithful slave. Right, so slave isn't derogatory. Our world has made it very bad. The way that man has used slaves is very bad. But our Heavenly Father, who has us as slaves, is the most benevolent, loving, caring slave owner anybody could possibly have had. And that's where we're at right now. We're in that spot. Chosen, bought, owned, provided for, all of those things. Maybe you're still sitting here this morning and going, I still don't like the idea of being a slave. I don't want to put that as part of my identity in Christ. It's hard for me to accept. Let's look at a few spots. Go to Philippians chapter 1. We just went through Philippians in detail here, the last sermon series. Philippians chapter 1. And what we're going to see as we go through these verses, right, just real quickly, is the fact that all of the apostles, at least those that have written books here, right? Paul, Peter, James, John, Titus, or Jude, all of them have no problem with this identity marker. None. Right? They introduce themselves. Paul sometimes introduces himself as an apostle or called by God or all of those things. But in Philippians chapter 1, verse 1, Paul and Timothy, servants, right? Again, cross that out. That's slaves. That's doulos, right? Paul and Timothy, slaves of Christ Jesus. Paul and Timothy have no problems identifying themselves that way. Right? They're writing letters to these people in Philippi and going, guess what we are? We're slaves of Christ. Right? They pronounce that right at the get-go. Same thing if you were to slide over to Romans 1:1, slaves of Christ. Titus 1:1, slaves of Christ. Right? Paul repeatedly identifies himself as a slave. And here's Paul, writer of what? Two-thirds of the New Testament? Paul's a pretty smart guy, right? Paul's pretty independent. Paul has a lot of things, and yet he says, I'm a slave. Does Paul not understand that he's a child and a co-heir and all? Of course he does. But he doesn't allow any of those identity markers to remove or to replace his identity as a slave. You would think if slave wasn't needed, you would think Paul in all these situations would walk in and go, Paul, adopted by Christ, Paul, reconciled by Christ, Paul, anything else. Right? And we'd be okay with those things. But instead, Paul goes, no. The ultimate picture of my relationship with my Lord is that of being a slave. A slave that is so in love with his master that we're obedient to him. Flip with me to the book of James. Got to remember, James is the half-brother of Jesus. James chapter 1. So again, you would think that James would come out and go, James, half-brother of Jesus, right? That's a much better picture, correct? That's a much better way to introduce myself. Hey, that guy that I'm asking you to follow, he's my brother. And I'm his half-brother. That's a good thing. And yet James comes in verse 1 of chapter 1. James, there's that word again, a servant. But it's doulos, James, a slave of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right? James takes it even farther. James goes, I'm a slave of God, but you know this guy who's my half-brother? I'm his slave too. Anybody here who has siblings willing to be a slave of their brother or sister? Anybody? I didn't think so. Right? None of us are willing to be a slave of our brother or sister. But James was. James understood the relationship. James realizes who's in control of his life, and it's not James. Right? James understands that. And then you got Peter. Slide a little bit farther. Go to Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Right? And repeat. Right? Nothing new, right? You'll see it again. 2 Peter 1:1. Simon Peter, a slave. But Peter also puts in there, an apostle of Jesus Christ, right? Double markers of his identity. I'm an apostle. He should have just left it there. Right? And I would have no problem going, you know what? I'm one that's sent by God too. And so when I introduce myself, John, I'm sent by God to do whatever. But Peter says, no. I'm a slave first. But I'm also an apostle. And are we willing to do that? And then you could go to Titus or Jude. Jude is the same thing. Right? If the book of Jude says he's a slave as well. And then you look at Revelation, book of Revelation all the way in, last book, right? Jude says he's a slave. The Revelation is 1:1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his slaves the things that must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his slave, John. Right? So, wait a minute. The Apostle John is what? The one whom Jesus loved, correct? He's the disciple Jesus loved. He's the one that John was the closest one. John is the one that Jesus looks at and goes, there's your mom. And mom, there's your son. And please take care of my mom. I'm not going to be her anymore. And yet John himself, who had this intimate, close relationship with Jesus, right, did all of these things with him. When he comes to the book of Revelation and he puts those things down on paper, the Holy Spirit moves him to write that he is God's slave. And yet we still fight it. I don't like being called a slave. Well, you know what? Maybe we need to start to accept some of that identity, because obviously the church fathers, the foundations, had no problems being called slaves. And maybe we need to start to see the slave as being a good thing, because that means we're no longer slaves of the old man. We're no longer slaves of sin, but we're slaves of Jesus Christ. Loving, caring, merciful, faithful, all of those things going down through it. So repeatedly, all the writers of the New Testament have no problem identifying themselves as being a slave, chosen, bought, owned, subjected, dependent, all of those things. Right? And so that's why when I look at it for myself, right, I now have this loving master who's wise, knows the beginning from the end. He knows what your life is going to turn into. Right? He's aware of it. He's got a plan for it, and he knows how to get you to the end that he wants. We just have to be willing to follow. We have to be willing to be obedient. We have to be willing to say, you know what, Jesus, you got the right way, and I'm going to follow that as he provides for us. Because he doesn't just leave us as a slave, he calls us friends and co-heirs. And just in case we're still having a problem, well, those are guys who walked with Jesus. They understood it. They experienced it. Right? Go back to the book of Philippians. Still having a problem with being a slave. Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. Do nothing from selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Right? We need to be humble people. Right? We need to put other people's interests before our own. We need to be willing to lay our lives down and allow other people to go first. Right? So there's humility, right? And it's important and it's needed. And then you look at it and continuing on, let each of you look not only to your own interests, but verse 5, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. Maybe you'll remember this. Maybe it's bringing back. Maybe the Holy Spirit's quickening in your heart right now. Who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself, taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So if you're still having trouble with being a slave, right, put the right word into that picture, right? Verse 7, but he emptied himself by taking on the form of a slave. Our Lord and Master, Jesus Christ, had no problem sitting there, right, having full rights, full authority, and he goes, I'm going to give all of that up, and I'm going to become a slave. I'm going to humble myself all the way down to the lowliest of the lowliest of the lowliest of the lowliest of spots. Right, which was pictured, if you will, at the Last Supper, correct? When they're sitting there around the table and all the disciples are sitting there arguing with one another, who's the greatest, I'm the greatest, you know, James and John are fighting, and James and John's mom goes and asks Jesus, hey, put him at the right and the left, and all this stuff is going on. Arguments about who's the best. And Jesus is sitting here watching it, the one who humbled himself, mind you, and said he's going to be come down and be like a man and be the lowliest of men, be a slave. And so he gets up from the table and he wraps some towel around his waist and he gets down and he washes the feet, which would have never have been done by a servant in that time. It would have been done by a slave. Not just any slave, but the lowliest of slaves. Now, you didn't hire people to wash feet. You commanded people to wash feet if you were the owner of the home. You had the slave and going, you, feet. And they went and did it. And yet that's what Jesus did. Talk about being a slave. Like that's how he saw himself. That's how he humbled himself to the point of death on a cross. And then you think about Jesus' life. If you read through the Gospels and you think about it, what does Jesus say repeatedly throughout there? I do what the Father tells me to do. That's all he said he did, right? I only do what my Father tells me to do. I only do what I see my Father doing. Right? And so that's all slave talk again. Jesus is going, I've humbled myself, I've came to the earth to be a slave, and I'm fully submitted to my Father, to my Master, to my Lord, to my God. Right? And so Jesus brings himself to that spot, and then it ends, if you will, at the perfect picture of what a slave looks like, right? You get all the way to the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus, again, being obedient to death, right? He's sitting in the Garden of Gethsemane, disciples around him, Judas about ready to betray him, right? And he's sitting there, sweating bullets, going, can I get out of this? Is there any other way, God? Is there anything else that I could do to get out of this situation? And yet, as an obedient slave, right, again, keeping that in mind, right, what does he say? Yet not my will be done, but yours. That's what a slave says. A slave is giving up their will. Their slave goes, I don't have a will anymore. My will is to do your will. And that's exactly what Jesus says in the Garden of Gethsemane. That's exactly what our Lord and Master says to us. Right? He says it to his Father, not my will, but your will be done. And he's asking you and I to do the same thing. Will we follow the one who set the example? Jesus set the example, church. He laid it out for us. And he proved, does he not, that our Father is faithful? Did God leave him in the tomb? No. Right, what does it say at Philippians, if you're still in there? Philippians 2, verse 9. Right. So Jesus takes on this form of a slave, and he's obedient to death, and death on a cross, right? Complete humiliation. Verse 9, therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name, exalted and bestowed upon him the name that is above every name, so that at it, the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Right? So Jesus takes the lowly form of a slave. God sees his perfect obedience, his perfect yielded heart to the Father, to his Master. And he goes, because of that, Jesus, I'm exalting you to the highest place. Right? I'm going to give you the name above everything that everybody else on earth and under the earth will result and will exalt and will confess that your name is Lord. That we too would submit ourselves to him as slaves. Jesus didn't have a problem being a slave. Should we? And I hope not. It's such a crucial part of our identity that, every writer opens up parts of their books, right? One of their letters with the fact that they're slaves. But yet it's missed repeatedly because our translations, our Bibles, don't convert it that way. They've softened the word. They've made it more palatable to the church, to the readers going, you're just a servant. You get to choose whether you want to be obedient or not. And that couldn't be farther from the truth. Right? Now, this isn't some cruel dictator, right? Not a cruel dictator at all, right? He's sitting there on his throne and showering us, mercy and grace. But we still are to yield ourselves and allow ourselves to be that. It's so clear and yet so hard to the flesh, right, that I have to put myself in complete submission to my Lord and my Master. Are we willing to do it, church? Are we willing to, as much as we are excited about all these other aspects of identity, which we should be, can we be just as excited, just as proud, just as humbled by the fact that I am a slave of God? Back to Romans 6. Back to where we started. Romans chapter 6. Repeating verse 20 through 22. For you, when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regards to righteousness, right? We had no requirements to be righteous when we were slaves of sin. Sin didn't care. There was no requirement of it. But that fruit, what fruit were you getting at the time from the things which you are now ashamed? For the end of these things is death. Verse 22, right? If you're sitting here this morning and you've professed that Jesus Christ is Lord, this is absolutely, positively, 100% of your identity. But now that you have been set free from sin, thank you, Jesus, right, and have become slaves of God, The fruit you get leads to sanctification, and its end is eternal life. Eternal life, worshiping and praising our Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. Absolutely 100% true. Why? Because our Father sent his Son. Jesus became a slave and went to the market, right, to purchase and redeem us, that we could be his slaves now. Eternally loved, eternally cared for, eternally showered with mercy and grace. Let's close out in prayer. Father, we just thank you for the truth of your word. Holy Spirit, I pray that as we've gone through this understanding, this of our identity that has been so covered over, that we would truly receive it, God, that we would truly allow you, Holy Spirit, to quicken it in our hearts that we are slaves and that it's not a bad thing. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful part of our identity that we are slaves to a merciful and loving God. That it is our pleasure and it is our joy to yield ourselves in obedience. That it is a joy to relinquish our will, to submit ourselves to your authority. God, we desire to do what pleases you. Father, I pray that if it's not our desire, if we still desire to be Lord of our lives, if we still desire to have a foot in the kingdom and a foot in the world, God, that Holy Spirit, you would help us to see the need to no longer do that. That it's not possible. That I can't be owned by two masters. Instead, that you desire, and you have already done the work, to redeem us and to pay the price. And what a price it was. What a bondage every one of us in this room and online has been under or is under as a slave of sin. And that slave master is only out for himself. He gets us to believe it's for our good, but it's not. And yet, when we confess, as Romans 10:9 says, when we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, and that you, God, raised him from the dead, that we are saved, and that we are transferred, and that we are purchased in that moment, and we are owned by a new master, help us to yield to you in that way. Help us to understand that even though we're slaves, that all these other things we listed earlier, that we're friends and we're children of God and we're accepted and we're loved and we're reconciled and all those things are true, and we need the fullness of this identity to keep us balanced. That all these parts of our identity give us the rounded character of a son or a daughter of the King. And let us live in that identity. Let us yield ourselves. Let us be like Paul and James and John and Jude, that freely and gladly introduce themselves as slaves of Jesus. We're slaves of you, Jesus. And I pray that we will no longer allow the enemy or the world or anything else to distort that view, but that we would willingly and humbly accept it and live out of it, just as we do all the rest. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we leave, right? I don't know, do you have a song? You're just going to play? That's fine. If you want to play, that's fine. If you have not gotten communion when you came in, if you want to go back and grab a cup at the entranceway, that would be fine. But I want you to take some time. If you're at home, you have some time to maybe get that as well, get the elements for yourself. But as Ali's playing here, right, just take some time, right, and actually ponder, am I okay with this parts of my identity? And am I willing to openly confess, as James and John and Peter and all the rest of them, that you are a slave of Christ? And then allow him to do that work inside of you. And I'll give you a few minutes here to just kind of ponder those things, and then we'll come back and take the Lord's Supper together as a family. it's interesting and fitting the way that the Lord has kind of aligned up our baptisms, right? And now the following week, the Lord's Supper, and we got to see the two pictures, right, of what Christ has done. Last week, we got to see our identifying ourselves, right? Two people are identifying themselves in their own death, burial, and resurrection, the same as what Jesus did. Right? We saw that picture of that death, burial, and resurrection in baptism. And now this week, right, we get to hold in our hands the elements that represent Jesus' body and blood that were shed for us, right? That were broken for us, that were made possible, that make it possible for us to have salvation. Right? And so it's not just, you know, a cup and some juice that we hold in our hand. It's what it represents. And every time we come to the table, we need to remind ourselves and allow it to remind us of the reality that our Lord and Savior, right, paid a high price for us to be redeemed. He paid a high price for us to be adopted as sons and daughters. That it wasn't something that was simple, as we said earlier, right? He bought us from the slave market, not with silver or gold, but with his body and his blood. And, that's what we hold in our hands, right, is that representation thereof. And so we come to the table, Lord God, grateful and thankful, Jesus, that you were willing to allow yourself to be broken, that you allowed your blood to be shed, that each one of us here would have the opportunity to become a son or a daughter, that we'd have the opportunity to become co-heirs with Christ, that we'd have the opportunity to be accepted and loved and redeemed and all those things of our identity. Because, Jesus, you came and you lived a life that was perfect and blameless and spotless and without sin. And then you yielded your body. You gave up your body as a sacrifice, as a payment to your Father, that we could be redeemed, that our sin could be forgiven. So as we peel back that first layer, Lord, and to reveal the wafer that represents your body, we don't take it lightly. We thank you that you yielded your body to be broken for us. And so we take the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for us. And as we peel back that next layer, revealing the juice that represents your blood, Jesus, the blood that was shed, that we might have salvation, that our sins might be forgiven, that they might be covered, that we might be washed white as snow. Lord, we come remembering the price that was paid. And so we take the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, shed for us. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would constantly remind us when we come to the table of the price that was paid, the price that was necessary for us to be redeemed, that we would not take it lightly, that we would understand the sacrifice that was made and would be grateful for it. We'd come with humble and thankful hearts for all that you have done, and that as we leave the table, we would have a desire to go out and to share that good news. We'd have a desire to go and share the gospel of Jesus Christ, of your death, burial, and resurrection with those that we come in contact with, that they too might be able to come and celebrate with us to the praise, honor, and glory of our Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a good week.